Hi, thanks for joining. My name is Craig Borthwick. I'm a partner in the Financial Services Group here at Deckard. I'm joined by Oliver Cooper and Richard Hay from Strikeman Ellett, who advise on EU tax policy matters, advising a number of industry bodies, and also Huey Wong, a partner at Walkers. We will address two main topics in this webinar. The first is, why has the Cayman Islands been added to the blacklist? And second, what is the impact of the blacklisting? Richard and Oliver will go into much greater detail on both these points, but in terms of a quick summary, you'll see from the slides, there's a quick chronology on the screen. The EU launched its initiative back in 2016 on tax transparency, fair taxation, and its fight on base erosion and profit shifting. In 2017, the Cayman Islands was included on a grey list for the lack of substance, and the European Union requested that the Cayman Islands implement certain legislation to deal with that perceived lack of substance. On the 4th of February this year, the EU Code of Conduct Group advised the EU Council to blacklist Cayman for not implementing the required legislation in time. On the 7th of February, coincidentally, the legislation was implemented, but that was not done in time for the 18th of February meeting today, where the Cayman Islands decided, the European Union decided to blacklist the Cayman Islands and include it on its list of non-cooperative jurisdictions, and its rationale being not having appropriate measures in place relating to economic substance in the area of collective investment vehicles. Again, the second point we'll cover, which Richard will cover in much greater detail, what is the impact of the blacklisting? First, just to be clear, this is not AISMD or OECD related. This is not the non-cooperative list included in the AISMD legislation, which would prevent non-European funds being marketed around the European Union. And second, this is not OECD related. This is not anything to do with them. They've signed off on the Cayman Islands legislation as being fit for purpose. The European Union has recommended that European member states take measures to deal with the blacklisting, and they, again, Richard will cover this in more detail, but that would include measures such as imposition of withholding taxes and charges. There are, of course, reputational and administrative issues that may result from this blacklisting. And of course, the next steps for the Cayman Islands are to commence the process of delisting. So that's the very, very high level summary. If I hand over to Richard, who will now give a bit more background as to why we are where we are, and the next steps and impacts, et cetera.
Thanks very much, Craig. I'm Richard Hay. I'm a tax partner at Stikeman Elliott in London. We advise in the area of tax and regulatory policy, including in Europe. We're going to deal with breaking news today. At 9:30 this morning, ECOFIN, which is an EU body comprised of EU finance ministers, revised the European list of non-cooperative countries for tax purposes, or commonly referred to as the EU tax blacklist. They added four new jurisdictions to the blacklist today: Cayman, Palau, Panama, and Seychelles. And as Craig mentioned, we're going to provide some background on where this list came from and what the implications are, particularly for Cayman Islands and the funds managed there. By way of summary, we're looking at a foot fault on timing in meeting EU deadlines. They were a few days late in passing their legislative amendments. It's likely they would be removed by October, possibly before that. They will suffer some reputational stress as a result of this, but based on past experience, we don't expect serious or administrative or legislative sanctions from the majority of EU countries in the meantime. We do have precedent for this. You may be aware that Bermuda was also blacklisted in March of 2019. They were delisted in May after tweaking their legislation. So they're only blacklisted for 2 months. At this stage, EU's altered its procedures with the plans to revise the blacklist only twice a year. So it could be, as I mentioned, that the blacklisting extends to October. So you see from the slide that's up now, the background is pretty much all here in this one slide. You see that Europe has 7% of global population, 25% of the world economy, and 50% of the world's social welfare payments. Now, this obviously puts considerable stress on Europe from a competitiveness point of view. I mean, it has other advantages. The U.S. Secretary of State described the EU as the most comfortable retirement home in the world. Well, of course, in order to afford this, you need high taxes. There's not universal enthusiasm for that. The other alternative, of course, is you could cut benefits, but that doesn't go down too well either. France already taxes at a rate which means 58% of production in the country is taxed and spent by the government. Contrast that with 20% in Hong Kong and Singapore and 35% in the U.S., and you get a sense of where the problems lie. You'll know that Russia had similar issues. They dealt with that through territorial expansion and building a wall around themselves to insulate themselves from global competition. Eventually, the wall falls over, and the EU's adopted a different strategy here. But here's the sort of political stress. As you can see here, we're in France. This is what President Macron sees through his window when he proposes raising gasoline taxes or, frankly, any kind of taxes, or cutting pensions. I mean, one of the workers in this protest said, "We have the best pension system in the world. Why would we change that?" Simple answer, because they can't afford it. So EU's has had the opportunity to view what Russia did. They've adopted a different strategy here, not insulating themselves, but they seek to impose their tax model on the rest of the world. So here's a summary of the goals in the EU tax blacklist. This is looking at it from the EU perspective. The agenda is principally political. It's a populist agenda. Rather surprisingly, the UK has done no economic research to evaluate the impact of restricting funding from jurisdictions like Cayman that pump a lot more money into the EU than comes out. And of course, their principal political goal here is more spending, but no extra tax. There's an important institutional dimension here. As you probably know, three institutions run the EU. There's Parliament, there's the Commission, which is the executive arm of Parliament, and there's the EU Council, which is comprised of the governments of EU member states. Constitutionally, EU member states control direct taxation, and you will have seen for years the EU Commission has it with a centralizing tendency, wants to transfer these powers to under their control and take them away from the member states. And they launched their initiative. They said it would apply to EU member states. They would lead by example. And the very next release they did said that they decided not to evaluate EU member states because they were already compliant. So they projected their program onto 100 other countries around the world. They examine 100. They apply their demands to 70 countries, but they exempt EU member states from evaluation because they know they wouldn't support the program if they, too, were subject to discipline under it. And finally, geopolitical. EU arguably has limited time as a world leader, so they seek to set global standards to halt their relative decline. And, of course, one way you can do that is by developing a program that you think flatters the EU fiscal model and export that to other countries. It's an audacious plan, but so far it seems to be working rather well. And as a result of this, as I mentioned, Cayman has been blacklisted today, and I know many of you will be wondering what are the consequences of those sanctions. I'm going to turn over to my colleague, Oliver Cooper, for some comment on that.
Thank you very much, Richard. So The EU did, after quite a few wrangles, agree in December some guidance on the adoption of sanctions. The guidance they adopted instructs member states to adopt at least one administrative measure and at least one legislative or tax measure. You can see on the slides there in front of you what they are. In terms of administrative measures, it's about either increasing the monitoring of transactions or increasing the audit risks for taxpayers benefiting from or transacting in the jurisdictions. And from the legislative or taxation measures, there are four options: non-deductibility of cost, application of CFC rules, imposition of withholding tax, and the limitation of any participation exemption. Now, I mentioned the fact that it's recommended and guidance only, because actually it doesn't seem as though there's any legislative capability of the EU to require its member states to enforce them. The blacklist itself, because direct tax is not a competence of the European Union per se, the blacklist is a non-legislative act. That is to say, it cannot be enforced by the CJEU, the Court of Justice of the European Union, if there were disputes between the EU and its member states about enforcing this. And so the consequence is unclear what would happen if a jurisdiction were to choose not to impose sanctions. And moreover, because member states are given a choice as to how to impose or what sanctions to impose, it might be that different member states adopt a different approach to sanctions. It might be that different member states adopt different approach to sanctions and impose different, what they call, defensive measures against blacklisted jurisdictions. So we can see on this slide here sort of timeline for the imposition and updating of sanctions in future. So as noted, the guidance was adopted in December. Member states have until the end of this year, January the 1st, 2021, to adopt those sanctions. As noted, it's unclear what would happen if they don't. But note that timeline, because January 2021 could fall after the date when Cayman might be expected to be removed from the blacklist in October of this year. So it's perfectly possible for that time for Cayman to have been removed by the time that sanctions must be imposed by your member states. And over the course of 2021, the EU is going to review the sanctions imposed by different member states. In 2022, consider whether the sanctions regime has to be amended or whether the EU itself has to adopt sanctions at an EU level. Hitherto, they haven't done that. And so as a consequence, it's a real test for the union solidarity to see whether member states are going to rise to the challenge and impose those sanctions themselves.
Great. So that's an overview of why we are where we are and some of the key impact points. I think at this point, there are questions coming in. So the actual overview is fairly simple. It's quite straightforward. This is, in broad terms, an issue with very little bite at the moment. But perhaps we should deal with some of the key questions that are coming through. Richard, Huey, what are the barriers and the timeline to Cayman becoming delisted? Maybe start with you, Huey.
So the salient point in terms of, as Richard described, the footfall, is essentially the enactment of legislation to cover private funds or closed-ended funds. So in that timeline, the ECOFIN subgroup, Code of Conduct subgroup, made its decision on the 4th of February. Cayman, actually, legislation to cover this was enacted on the 7th of February, so that was the timing issue. So that legislation, as I understand it, you have not indicated that legislation does not satisfy what has been requested of Cayman, so that legislation is actually in place as of today. So there is no obvious thing that needs to be done other than that it wasn't done at the time of the actual assessments by the EU.
And the European Union actually made the point in their press release that this was a timing issue, whereas it wasn't at that point clear whether it was a technical implementation issue or timing, but it seems clear from the EU press release it was a timing issue.
Yes. So the list is essentially a list of uncooperative states, as it were, but the press release does note that Cayman's on it because it hasn't satisfied the timing deadline.
And the obvious question there is was there a reason the committee decision today couldn't have taken into account the fact that law was enforced by today's date?
Well, they were made aware that the legislation's in place, but I guess decision making in big institutions are more like an oil tanker than a speedboat, so you have to abide by, I'll choose my word neutrally, you have to navigate a bureaucracy or legislative process to make things, and timelines are taken very formally, I guess.
Yeah, thanks, Huey. Oliver, maybe a question for you, and it's just a broad one about, you know, what is the likelihood of a member state actually taking unilateral action to impose one of these measures the European Union has recommended? I mean, what's the chance of, say, one of the continental European member states actually imposing withholding taxes or charges on transactions with say, Cayman Islands domiciled entities?
Well, we're already seeing some withholding taxes and unilateral measures being adopted. You saw that in the Dutch blacklist, for example, adopted a few weeks ago. And the same is true, of course, of the French blacklist. One thing that's really important to note is that the blacklist might give jurisdictions within the EU, member states within the EU, an excuse to breach really what's one of the fundamental principles of the EU, which is free movement of capital. Article 63 of the Treaty on the Functioning of the European Union prohibits restrictions on the free movement of capital between EU member states and third countries except in exceptional circumstances. I think one of the arguments that could be made by some member states who are slightly more protectionist and slightly more averse to transactions that take place within IFCs like Cayman, one of the arguments they could make is actually now we've got a blacklist that allows us to derogate and deviate from that provision within the Treaty on the Functioning of the European Union. So it's possible they have unilateral measures, but it's really important to note that would be, to an extent, cutting off their nose to spite their face.
Yeah. I guess one point to draw out is that whether there's an EU-wide sanction or individual member state sanction, we're really talking about potentially individual member state sanctions.
Absolutely.
Because this is outside the EU process, and it really is from what you said.
Yeah, there are a couple of very small print provisions within EU law right now that discriminate against jurisdictions on that list, but that's to do with, for example, European development aid and so on and so forth. It's not about access to European markets and similar, and it's unlikely that those will be adopted at a union level anytime soon.
I think the critical point to take on board there is that constitutional jurisdiction over direct tax is exclusively a member state prerogative. So the EU has been trying for some time to get general agreement amongst the member states on sanctions they could apply across the entire union, and individual member states are jealously guarding their current constitutional capability to control direct tax.
Yeah. Obviously, very key question coming in is to what extent do we still see Cayman as an appropriate place to set up fund structures? I think there's two points I'd like to draw out here. Is one that number one, we hope this is a temporary measure, and Cayman is a very effective jurisdiction from which to raise assets on a global basis, and for a long time has not been the vehicle of choice to raise assets from European investors. And given that these are European sanctions, it's the European sanctions list, yes, it further underlines the fact that raising money from Europe is probably better through UCITS or European fund structures. It should not detract from the ability for Cayman to raise assets on a global basis.
I guess just following on from that point, Craig, and Richard and Oliver, correct me if I'm wrong. So as of the immediate, has the world changed in a tangible sense, I guess, into these decision-making process, today, tomorrow versus yesterday? I think the answer is no, I think.
Yeah, I would agree with that. And as I mentioned, in the Bermuda context, it was treated with a shrug. I mean, there's so much of this news out there these days. This is really done for political reasons by the EU. I mean, even in their own interest, they are damaged by this kind of thing. For example, funding for the development of East European states would be jeopardized. It could even risk a geopolitical shift. Place like Cayman's conscious of the Chinese Belt and Road Initiative. The Chinese would love to have their help there. EU doesn't want to risk that. They don't have sanctions they can apply at the moment. I think the actual on-the-ground impact on Cayman, I wouldn't expect much over the blacklisting period.
The questions come in, dealt with quite quickly. What opportunities do you see this presenting for other offshore jurisdictions? I think is probably neutral on that point, assuming that Cayman is off the list, is hopefully in October. it shouldn't really detract from Cayman's ability to raise assets. I think one interesting point, Richard, that you made earlier was that we don't think Ireland and Luxembourg are necessarily going to be overjoyed by this. Whilst in the short term, it obviously presents opportunities to European fund domiciles, the measures which are behind this, or the rationale behind these measures, are very much issues would affect that would affect Ireland and Luxembourg in the same way.
Yeah, I mean, it would be natural if many thought that they would be advantaged by this, and perhaps in the short term they might be. But they can see the long-term drift on this. The European Commission is mounting this initiative in order to bring them to heel as well. So they can see quite clearly that this poses long-term risk for them as well. And they, our understanding is that within the decision-making process, they've been pretty assertive about protecting the right of funds jurisdictions, including those outside the EU. I don't think they're taking any joy in this outcome. The other thing I would say is that, and Oliver knows a lot about this, the EU funds are very heavy investors in Cayman themselves at professional level, as many and on the call will know. Primary investor in Cayman funds are EU-based funds who get enhanced returns by investing there. So I think we can take it, and certainly this, we've seen this in our discussions, the EU states, at least those who operate finance centers, will not be happy about this.
Huey, this might be one for you. The question, is there any impact on European Union service providers, especially AFIMs or administrators, et cetera, of Cayman funds?
Yeah, so potentially, so I think one point is, just to take a step back and answering that question, it's called a blacklist, obviously that's a colloquial term, so really it's as Richard and Oliver outlined, it's a list where the EU have decided how other jurisdictions should change their law. So what's happened here is actually the request has been made, the law has been changed, but not done on the timing that they were asked to do. So what we're really dealing with is no one likes to be on something that is colloquially called a blacklist. So if you're a compliance officer sitting in the compliance department of a financial institution, and you're running your risk management software, and paying, obviously the word blacklist will, and Cayman will show up, that person is inevitably going to, because not to call people a jobs worth, but they'll apply a certain process of, oh, this is high risk. So that will be the practical impact, but substantively no facts on the ground have changed. And I guess to really belabor the point, blacklist does not imply moral opprobrium or untoward behavior. It is simply one jurisdiction has not changed its law in time to the liking of another jurisdiction is a neutral way of putting it.
Yeah, I guess to step back from that, it's very, I completely agree, Huey. What the EU has done here is demand changes in tax laws, commercial laws, corporate laws in 70 countries around the world. I mean, this is audacious, extraordinary. It's never happened before in world history. They have achieved some success on this on a remarkable scale, but it is historically unprecedented. And it is part of the process of globalization. We find ourselves in the midst of a 50-year period of the globalization project. There's competition between various jurisdictions, including the EU and the US, to control that agenda. These countries realize that rigging the rules of the game confers very significant economic advantage. And you've seen the disputes between the U.S. and Brussels over digital taxation. This is all just part of that space. And of course, it's exacerbated by the Brexit developments. Brussels contemplates a shot across the bow of the United Kingdom just to let them know if they develop a tax model that's asymmetric with that in the EU or indeed regulatory initiatives generally. They'll fight back. This is part of a big geopolitical battle, and unfortunately, Cayman, being a relatively small player, is considered an expendable by Brussels. If you've been following this closely, you'll see that They also mooted the possibility of blacklisting Turkey, and they backed off from that because of their wider geopolitical significance. And you will have seen the same thing happen when the EU proposed an anti-money laundering blacklist that included Saudi early in the year, last year. They backed off blacklisting Saudi because of geopolitical importance. Unfortunately, Cayman doesn't have that, but it, in our view, certainly doesn't affect the economic desirability of the proposition there.
One of the questions we've had, which we touched upon earlier, was to what extent would this affect the ability to market Cayman funds in Europe? Just to reiterate, under Article 36 and 42 of AIFMD, it refers to one of the conditions of marketing a fund being that the AIFE or the fund not be listed as a non-cooperative country and territory by the FATF. This is not that list. This is a European Union list. It's nothing to do with AIFMD. It's nothing to do with the OECD. So it won't affect the ability from a regulatory perspective to market funds under the private placement regimes within the European Union. Of course, though, it just reiterates, as I said earlier, the reputational issues and perception that's connected with offshore funds, and the fact that, for whatever reason, the way the legislation's going is that investors are encouraged to invest into European funds increasingly. Richard Oliver, is there any particular view on how the US might react to this, or how this might affect the US managers?
The first thing to note is how blasé and disconnected from this the US is. When the previously mentioned anti-money laundering blacklist was published last year, the US Treasury took the quite extraordinary step of instructing their financial institutions to completely ignore that list. And that's because they saw it as being invented for political reasons rather than because of a reflection of a real risk. So it's likely that something similar will happen again. That's probably a good thing. Of course, most Cayman business is US-oriented rather than EU-oriented. And it's also been noted, as Richard said earlier, a lot of the pressure around this move is related to Brexit. It's about the EU wanting to fire a shot over the UK's bows, but it's also been seen within Washington as firing a shot across the Trump administration's bows. There have been disputes over tax, and particularly over digital taxes recently, and this is seen by some actors within Washington as another act within that play.
I would say, Craig, an interesting sidelight on this is the EU has, on a number of occasions, threatened to blacklist the United States under the same issue. Given its geopolitical importance, it's backed away from the brink on that one. But it certainly, there's no love lost between the US and the EU on this one.
We're getting a lot of questions. So after the webinar, we will try and respond in person to all of these questions. One, and it's coming up a few times, is that, aside from all of these discussions we have as to the background for all of this, if member states were to pass legislation enacting the defensive measures the European Union have referred to, what's the worst case scenario? What is the worst case we could have here? Is the worst withholding tax at a punitive rate?
Yeah. I think you could, conceivably you might see that. I think it's quite unlikely in this context because, of course, it disadvantages any investors from the country and discourages a fund flow into it.
Yeah.
So they have skin in this game.
So that would include dividends to investors from Cayman funds, payments between European entities and Cayman entities, vice versa.
Yeah, when you get blacklisted by France, as they occasionally do, they employ, France is an extreme jurisdiction on this. They apply.
Although interestingly, they only recently released their sanctions list, and the Cayman Islands is not on that list.
Correct. That's right.
Do you think they'll revise that?
Of course, that comes up in a different context. That's because they're seen to be too slow in responding, and that affected Bahamas and
BVI.
BVI.
So if France does, and we think might blacklist Cayman,
So the French blacklist law does require the French blacklist each year to be updated to include at least all the jurisdictions on the EU's common blacklist. So if that blacklisting takes place in December, January, so if Cayman is not removed by this coming December or January next year, then it would be included on the French blacklist.
And implications?
It's unclear because, of course, France could go further because of the green light given to it by the EU. In terms of direct implications, it's a withholding tax.
It's fair to say that it's always been the French's prerogative to blacklist who it wants. So in a way, obviously, this politically gives them some cover, but they've always had a free hand as of yesterday. They're no freer to do it today than yesterday.
The question, do we think this is a political maneuver in light of Brexit?
Well, Politico, which is the insider's guide to politics, made that comment today. A shot across the UK bounds for Brexit. It could be a good sign for the Cayman in that it would enlist some UK support.
And that's actually another. Another question is do you think the UK will get involved in this?
They have a lot of their own issues to deal with at the moment. They may well remonstrate privately, but they don't have a lot of political capital in Brussels at the moment.
I mean, to give a sort of an alternative view, perhaps, as well. It's important not to lose sight of, Brexit inevitably, or the Brexit, post-Brexit negotiations obviously must be relevant to this. But at the same time, to come back to the football issue, Bermuda last year committed the same football, so they were taken off the list. BVI today were taken off the grey list and put onto the white list. So it's, Cayman are not, there's no obvious reason in that battle to differentiate Cayman from the other Crown dependencies either. So they have played fair. So, there was a foot fault.
And that's an important point, actually, because some of the misreporting on this, and it's to do with the way the European Union summarized the reason for the blacklisting, was that there was a lack of economic substance or economic activity in respect of investment funds. Yeah. Now, just to be clear, that relates to closed-ended funds, which were not previously regulated by CEMA, which as of the 7th of February are now regulated by CEMA. And that would then, according to the OECD and the European Union, who have signed off on this law, would rectify their issue.
Thanks for that question, whoever asked it. They have used the term economic substance, and obviously recently there's been economic substance legislation that's been enacted. So it's important, although it's important to differentiate those two. So there's one which is the economic substance regime, which the EU promulgated against, and again measured everyone, and in fact that's what Bermuda committed the foot fault against last year, and those are the ones with the 9 relevant activities, and people on this dialing into this webinar possibly in the Cayman context would be familiar with it most in the Cayman investment manager context. That's a civil thing, although they've used the same term. This is separate to that regime. So Cayman enacted that last year, and the EU raised no issues, and it was not put on the blacklist like Bermuda. So this is simply, as you say, Craig, enacting legislation to cover closed-ended funds or private funds, as Cayman's legislation calls it. But it came in on the 7th of February.
And we're comfortable, or broadly, the view is that the changes to the civil regime in respect of offshore managers, which either requires the direct registration of Cayman managers with CEMA, or the procurement model or the outsourcing model, etc., whatever we call it, being implemented, or the winding up of offshore managers. We think those laws are robust enough.
And in fact, Cayman, did cooperate with the EU. So Cayman actually enacted its legislation at the tail end of 2018, start of 2019. To comply with the economic substance demands, and actually they changed it again on the civil point. So the EU, they passed a version which they thought complied, and the EU said, actually, no, can you make further changes? And Cayman did make further changes. So if you recall, originally civil exempt managers were actually outside of the economic substance regime, and they thought that complied, or the EU, I wouldn't say, I was about to say changed its mind, but anyway, said, actually, no. So Cayman actually made amendments to its economic substance regime to comply with that. So it did cooperate in that instance, actually.
Yeah, Cayman's adopted 15 pieces of legislation over the course of this initiative to implement EU requirements. So we're not looking at a jurisdiction here.
that's positioned itself as a rogue on this. We're looking at a jurisdiction which has generally remained in very close compliance.
Oliver, one for you. Any comments on the reports circulating that the Tax Justice Network will release its secrecy jurisdictions listing tomorrow and revised Cayman up the list as to number one negative jurisdiction ahead of Switzerland and the USA. There's a view, there was a point made by one of the listeners that it's no coincidence that the European Commission is one of the main funders of the Tax Justice Network. What is the importance of the Tax Justice Network and what do you expect to see?
Yes, I believe it may even have been published right now. It's come out today. You haven't seen the results. Tax Justice Network is a major player in lobbying politicians across the globe, but particularly within Brussels and London, to conform to their agenda. They've pushed a number of initiatives that have become law on transparency and beneficial ownership and similar. I would have a note of caution about their financial secrecy index. It's calculated by actually multiplying the actual secrecy score they give the jurisdiction with the size of the jurisdiction's assets that are actually held by entities or arrangements there. And so the consequence, Cayman is not the most secret jurisdiction when you multiply the score they've given for secrecy with the obviously very large number of assets they have being managed there, or being held there rather. And that is why they're high at the scoreboard. It's a concocted list that tries to obviously make financial centers look worse than they are. But it does have an impact on politicians and policymakers, but I don't think it's necessarily a reflection of reality.
So the risk of sounding partisan, you're less likely to do well on this list if you're more successful as a jurisdiction, it sounds like, that more people who use it.
So Richard, I think you mentioned earlier that the French and the Dutch may have made or adopted some measures against Cayman already. What measures were you referring to?
So the Netherlands did adopt its blacklist, I think it was about 5 or 6 weeks ago, in which they did similarly name a lot more jurisdictions than just the ones on the EU blacklist. Their list requires, like France's, the naming of every jurisdiction that's on the EU blacklist, but they, just like France, can always and always been able to name more jurisdictions on that list. In the Netherlands case, I believe it's to do with enhanced monitoring of transactions and audit risk rather than legislative and tax implications.
And so just to reiterate, because the question has come up a few times, the worst case scenario is that the European member states start to implement withholding taxes against transactions between Cayman and European entities. And that would be tax due on payments received from the Cayman Islands. So that would be dividends from fund structures or redemptions from fund structures in Cayman or any other payment that's made from Cayman to European entity or person. That's what might be subject to withholding taxes.
Absolutely. Of course, as noted before, member states are adopting these on an individual basis. It's absolutely possible, of course, given there's free movement of capital within the European Union, and that's not going to be changing, and that different member states do not choose to impose withholding tax, and therefore, as a consequence, it would be up to those arrangements and structures to be formulated that allow the monies to come into the European Union by a jurisdiction that's a bit more sensible about which sanctions they adopt.
Just if I may ask a related question on that point. So this blacklisting, or certainly withholding tax changes, I imagine they're subject to the individual legislative processes of the individual states, just because these are democracies. And so they won't come from bolts from the blue. There'll be time to see these coming, and there'll be the lobbying processes.
Quite right. This is a domestic prerogative for individual member states.
So I think we are running out of time. We will follow up, as they on we've got maybe 50 or so questions on this. So I think one of the questions I wanted to ask Huey, we've got a few minutes still, is in light of the timing issue, the legislation was kind of ready, and yet, you know, a good week or so after the legislation was implemented, we have this sanctions list published. Do you think the European Union are going to now require, as a perceptional matter, as a political matter, further legislation from Cayman to appease the European Union, to make it look as capricious, as you said,
Yeah, so I am, just to be clear, entering into the realms of my personal speculation on this. I think there might, yeah, so no reasons have been, or there's no clarity on whether the legislation now in the context of the list has come out, so automatically the thing becomes escalated, the emotional temperature now becomes escalated. So although we're confident that substantively the legislation complies, and you know, there's precedent, if you compare the legislation to BDI, absolutely the same, but obviously there's always room to pick on technical amendments, because I don't think any person, including ourselves, can ever read any piece of paper without making changes. So it is very, very, it is a possibility, but I imagine within, it'll be difficult to conceive of amendments they might ask for that Cayman would not just straightforwardly accommodate, yeah, given they've essentially substantively done what they need after them.
And last question, I guess, for the panel. Can we draw on Bermuda in terms of the experience? There are always rumours when Bermuda is put on the blacklist, you know, the ability to make transfers to Bermudan entities, the ability to set up bank accounts for Bermudan entities, etc., would be a lot more difficult. Was that a fear that was realised in practice, or was that actually not the case?
I think my understanding is, on the ground, the impact of that, the practical impact of that, was quite limited. Mm. We are a little further along in the process from a timing point of view. People have seen that Bermuda went on and off in a relatively short period without consequences. So I think that will probably tend to inform people that what's happening here is just a process, frankly, of EU moving in turn to whack each one of these jurisdictions from courger les autres. This is just the way they do it. So Bermuda's now moved to the whitelist. I don't see any long-term damage in their relationship with the EU. It's just an opportunity for them to make a political point. The fiscal problems aren't ours here in France. They're caused by these tax-free jurisdictions abroad.
Great. Well, I just want to thank Huey, Oliver, and Richard for joining today. If anyone has any further questions, do feel free to email them through. We will respond in writing to each one. And thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you.